All right, so let's shift gears a little bit. Let's talk about altered levels of consciousness.
Okay.
I gotta say, this one always kind of scares me a little bit.
It can be intimidating, yeah.
Where do we even begin to talk about this?
Well, it's a complex area for sure,
Yeah.
but understanding some of the basics can really make a huge difference. So, first off, it's really important to try to differentiate between some key terms
Yeah.
like delirium, dementia, lethargy, stupor, and coma.
So there's a spectrum of altered consciousness.
Exactly.
The source that we're looking at seems to focus on coma, which is defined as a GCS score of less than 8.
That's right.
Now, the source mentions this really helpful mnemonic, AEIOU tips for remembering possible causes of
Oh,
coma.
yes, I love that one.
Can you walk us through that?
Absolutely. It's such a great tool to have in your back pocket, especially in those emergency situations.
Yeah.
So AEIOU TIPS-S stands for alcohol, epilepsy, infection, overdose, uremia, trauma, insulin, poisoning, and stroke.
Wow. Okay.
So it helps you just kind of quickly run through some of the most common and serious causes of coma.
It's like a mental checklist.
It is.
Now, I noticed that the source differentiates between two main categories of coma:
Okay.
toxic metabolic versus primary CNS disease or trauma. Can you break those down?
So think of it this way. Toxic metabolic coma is kind of like a system-wide shutdown caused by something that's messing with the body's chemistry. This could be anything from a drug overdose to a severe infection, organ failure, even a simple electrolyte
Oh,
imbalance.
wow.
Whereas primary CNS disease or trauma suggests a problem within the brain or spinal cord itself, like a stroke, a brain tumor, or traumatic brain injury.
So in one case, the body is all out of whack,
Yeah.
and in the other, it's a direct hit to the central nervous system. And the source actually has a figure visualizing all the different causes of coma.
Oh, that's fantastic. Visual aids can be so helpful,
So helpful.
especially when you're trying to understand these really complex concepts.
Right. So for our listener, definitely check out that figure in the source material. So we kind of have an understanding now of the different types of coma and
Yeah.
what some of the potential causes are.
Right.
Now, how do we manage it? What are the steps involved in managing altered LOC?
Okay, well, first and foremost, it's all about gathering as much information as possible.
Okay.
We really need to play detective
So
here.
it's like detective work.
It is. So we want to talk to family, friends, anyone who might know the patient's medical history, any medications they take, or if they've been acting differently lately.
So you're really building a complete picture.
Exactly. And even seemingly small details can be really helpful in these situations.
For sure.
I mean, even if a family member just mentions that the patient hasn't been feeling well for a few days, that could be a big clue. It might point us towards an infection or an underlying medical condition that
Okay.
we wouldn't have known about otherwise.
So along with taking the history, I'm assuming a physical exam is crucial as well.
Absolutely. A really comprehensive physical exam, particularly a detailed neurological exam, is vital.
And in that neurological exam, the pupils are really important.
The pupils are key.
What can they tell us?
Oh, the pupils can tell us so much about what's going on in the brain.
Okay.
For example, if somebody have a head injury and their pupils are unequal in size or they don't react to light normally,
Right.
that could be a sign of increased pressure in the brain,
Yeah.
which is a huge red flag.
So those little black circles are holding a lot of information.
They are.
And along with the history and the physical, I imagine there's some investigations that you might order.
Yes, absolutely.
Oh.
So along with the physical, we might order blood tests to check for infections, drug overdoses, metabolic imbalances, and imaging, like a CT scan of the head, might be necessary to look for any structural abnormalities, like bleeding or tumors.
So again, you're trying to put together all these pieces, the
Yeah.
history, the physical exam, the investigations to figure out what's going on.
Exactly. It's like putting a puzzle together.
Right. And the source mentions that it can be tough sometimes to tell the difference between a structural versus a toxic metabolic coma.
It can be tricky, yeah.
Why is that?
Well, because the clinical picture might evolve over time.
Oh, okay.
So what that means is a patient's condition can change rapidly.
Oh, wow.
You know, we need to be really vigilant and reassess frequently,
Right.
especially in the early stages when the cause of the altered LOC might not be immediately clear.
So you're constantly evaluating and reevaluating.
You don't have to.
Now, the source actually provides a table listing the toxic metabolic causes of fixed pupils, highlighting how pupil dilation or constriction can be a really big clue.
Right. It's amazing how much information we can get just from looking at the pupils.
It is. It really is. So let's talk about treatment.
Okay.
Once we identify the cause of the altered LOC, what are the next steps?
Well, the first thing we always do is address any immediate life-threatening issues.
Right.
So making sure that the patient has a clear airway and that they're breathing adequately.
Okay.
And then we focus on treating the underlying cause.
Okay.
So if it's a drug overdose, we might give an antidote. If it's an infection, we'll start antibiotics.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a structural problem, like a brain bleed, surgery might be necessary.
So it's a multi-pronged approach.
Absolutely.
But while you're figuring all of that out, are there any standard treatments that you would give for pretty much every case of altered LSE?
Yes. Actually, there's a really helpful mnemonic for this.
Okay.
Don't D.
Don't TT. Yeah. What does that stand for?
It stands for dextrose, oxygen, naloxone, and thiamine.
Okay.
These are often the first line treatments that we give while we're still working to figure out the underlying cause,
mm-hmm.
and they can make a huge difference in preventing further damage.
I like it, DNT.
Yeah, it's easy to remember.
So why is each one of those components so important?
Okay, well, let's start with dextrose.
Okay.
So hypoglycemia, or low blood sugar, can actually mimic a lot of neurological conditions,
right.
including coma.
Oh, wow.
So giving dextrose is a quick way to rule that out, and it could honestly be life-saving.
Yeah.
And then oxygen, and it's pretty self-explanatory, but oxygen is essential for brain function.
Right.
And any condition that compromises breathing or circulation can lead to hypoxia, which is low oxygen levels in the brain.
Right.
So giving supplemental oxygen can help improve brain function and potentially prevent further damage.
Just like giving the brain a boost.
Exactly. Yeah. And then we have naloxone, which you might know is the medication we use to reverse opioid overdoses.
Right.
So opioids like heroin, fentanyl, and even some prescription painkillers can suppress the respiratory system,
mm-hmm.
which can obviously lead to decreased consciousness and even death.
Yeah.
Naloxone really quickly reverses those effects, restoring breathing and consciousness. It's a lifesaver in those situations.
It's amazing how such a simple medication can have such a huge effect.
It is. And then finally, thiamine.
Okay.
Thiamine deficiency is often seen in people who have chronic alcohol abuse or malnutrition,
mm-hmm.
and it can lead to Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome,
which
is a serious brain disorder that can cause confusion, memory loss, and even coma.
Wow.
So giving thiamine can help prevent or treat those complications.
So DONE-NT really covers a lot of ground.
It does.
You're looking at hypoglycemia, you're giving oxygen, you're reversing potential opioid overdoses, and preventing or treating thiamine deficiency.
Yep.
It's a brilliant mnemonic.
It's a good one.
So now the patient is stable, you're treating them.
Right.
The decision has to be made, do we admit them, do we discharge them, what goes into that decision?
Well, if the altered LOC is readily reversible and the patient is otherwise stable.
Okay.
They might be able to go home with appropriate follow-up care.
Okay.
But if the condition is more serious, like a stroke or a severe infection, or if the patient needs ongoing monitoring and treatment,
right.
admission to the hospital is usually necessary.
So it really comes down to the individual patient and what their needs are.
It does.
This has been really informative so far.
Yeah, it's fascinating stuff.